Okay, we're live. Sweet.
Sweet.
All right, so just go ahead and answer the question again. I'll just edit it out.
Oh, sure. So I was in the nonprofit space for 20 years, and in 2008 started to help my wife set up a small home-based business. It's called Liberty Jane Clothing, and we started on eBay. Real simply, she would design doll clothes and then sell them, and we got real good at selling at sort of what you'd call ultra-premium prices, you know, a couple hundred bucks for doll clothes. But after 18 months, she totally burned out of sewing and selling, and so we had to find a new business model. And so what we realized was, you know, she was creating unique designs, and she could package them up as patterns and sell them as PDF files. So we started down that track, and it really scaled in the fall of 2009. I think the first month we sold 11 patterns. Now we do about 10,000 a month. Down, we created a marketplace for those patterns, and it's called pixiefair.com. And so we really consider ourselves sort of the leading online space for doll clothes patterns, which is this funny little niche.
It's totally a niche market. I've heard something like that before. And the cool thing about your story is that, you know, we always talk about, like, the starving artist, right? Like, because, you know, you spend so much time as an artist creating your work, whether it's writing your books or, you know, designs or whatever. And what's really cool about your business is that you guys basically systemized something that you think you can't normally systemize. I mean, you took the designs, instead of selling them one by one, the end product, you're selling the actual design as a digital download. Like, I think that's amazing.
Yeah, that's right. So that was the basic idea, and it totally scaled. You know, I think I just added up the numbers because we just, you know, ended the calendar year here, and we've done a total of 352,000 of those doll clothes patterns downloaded from our sites over, you know, the last 4 years. Mm-hmm. So how I got into the, you know, sort of marketing book space and traditional publishing and self-publishing is we started a program for the people who would buy our patterns called Liberty Jane Partners, and we would basically give them marketing tips. You know, I'd give little webinars, and I'd do a newsletter for them. And we have about 1,300 of them on a list. So when Pinterest came along, I thought, you know, I'm going to blog for those ladies, but I'm going to do it publicly. And because everything else had always been sort of just emails to them or, you know, something like that. So I decided to put out a blog publicly, really for them. It's called marketingonpinterest.com. And so over Christmas 2011, I totally just set it up. It was, you know, it was an $11 WordPress blog and just started knocking out content. And I think I did, like, you know, 24 articles inside of the first 3 weeks or something like that, you know. And 2 weeks after setting it up, I got contacted by an author, and she said, hey, I'm a professional author, and I want to write a book on Pinterest, and I don't know enough about it in terms of business stuff. You seem to be the online expert, so would you consider co-authoring it with me? And I didn't stop to say, I've only been blogging about it for 2 weeks, you know? But I said, sure. So she said, let me set up a call with my agent, and we'll go from there. And as soon as she said that, I was like, whoa, this is serious, you know? So it turned out that she introduced me to her agent. That person, her name's Marilyn Allen. Since then, she's become my agent. And we went from there. They had a publisher they were trying to pitch the book to, or they thought they had the makings of a deal that fell apart. And then the agent pitched it to, you know, her contacts at different New York you know, publishers, and got traction in just a few weeks. And so that was Pinterest Power. That was the book that came out. I proposed that title to them, and without the idea of creating a catalog of books around that, but they liked that title well enough to choose it, and I had the domain. So we worked on that book, and when that started to come together and we finished it, I realized what authors call your back catalog. was stuff I had. You know, I had stuff that I had written for those 1,300 seamstresses. And so I thought, gosh, I could actually put out two or three self-published books on Kindle before the Pinterest book even comes out. So that's what I did. I kind of reworked old content and came out with eBay auction power and with email marketing power. And then the self-published book that's really done the best, it's been in a legit number one bestseller in several categories, is Craft Business Power. Mm-hmm. And that was all, you know, back catalog stuff that I already had. And so then the kind of conclusion of the story is that the McGraw-Hill people were the ones who picked up the book, the Pinterest Power book, and they, after it was out and after it had done well, I circled back and arranged, we arranged a two-book contract. So Instagram Power came out with McGraw-Hill, and then YouTube Marketing Power just came out in this last couple weeks with McGraw-Hill. So I've got three McGraw-Hill books and three self-published books at this point.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. And what I love about your story is how you got picked up on that blog. You know, like, that was basically the beginning of Pinterest back then, right? So you were obviously probably one of the first, if not the first guy, blogging out there about how to use Pinterest to grow your business. And, of course, now Pinterest is huge, especially for craft businesses. You know, the demographic is mostly women. I mean, it's just a huge, huge opportunity for businesses now. But you were one of the first guys to see that, and that's why you got picked up. That's why you got noticed. Yeah. So that's something I try to tell authors is that you have to understand there are trends and there are waves of how the economy goes. And so if you can become an expert on something that's just starting to peak in interest with the public, then when you write a book on that subject or, you know, a blog post or whatever it is, you can get really noticed really quickly. And that's how you see people who are, you know, overnight successes. It's not really that you were an overnight success. I mean, obviously you've been, you know, teaching the people in your business for years about how to do marketing online. Yeah. You just happened to be in the right place at the right time.
Yeah, and I had kind of seen that. I mean, I think you're exactly right. I had kind of seen that pattern with a few different sort of gurus. You know, I had seen how, as a social media platform would come out, a guru or, you know, industry leader would sort of write the definitive book. And, you know, I saw Guy Kawasaki do that with Google+. Chris Brogan did it with Google+. Right. Joel Comm did it with Twitter. His book was Twitter Power. Right. Coincidentally, I didn't try to steal his naming construct in any way. But I had seen that trend, right? So that was a model. And I thought, well, I'm not an industry leader in any way. But I could still copy that model and do it just in terms of blogging and see where it would go from there. And you're right. I mean, it totally did work. It was sort of the cutting edge. What I didn't understand at the time was, which you obviously already know this, is that in the traditional publishing space, those acquisition editors are out there bird-dogging every possible concept and trying to find authors who are in alignment with the trends and the upcoming hot topics. And it's really like an arms race, you know, in New York between the publishers. You know, when a topic like Pinterest comes along, it's a race to get the right author and the right book out there first. And first mover advantage is huge. Mm-hmm. So I didn't realize that, but that's kind of how it works in New York. So when I proposed Instagram Power, the answer was, of course, yes. You know, that was an easy one because no one, even now, I think, the only traditionally published book on Instagram marketing right now. And that's not rocket science, you know?
And it just makes sense because it's the trend right now. It's something that's new, it's huge, it's blowing up. But, of course, I mean, if you went to the publishers and said, hey, let's do a book on MySpace Power, they'd be like, well, you're crazy. Of course not.
Yeah. You know, it was actually funny. I pitched both Instagram Power and YouTube Marketing Power. And they said, thumbs up to Instagram Power. And then they said, you know, we could take another book on YouTube too, but it just didn't have the same social urgency, you know, in terms of the market need. But YouTube was actually the platform that we have the most, in terms of our own work, our most credibility on, and the most proven work in, and really know the most about, you know. So that was the book that I was the most comfortable writing. but it was probably the least interesting to the traditional publisher. But they went with the two-book deal anyway. And I think it's a great book, you know. And YouTube's changed hugely in the last year. They did a massive refresh, so it kind of created a good reason to have a new book out on YouTube. So,
Gotcha. Yeah. So tell us about that whole process. I mean, what was it like to get kind of picked up by that publisher, to co-author the book with your partner? How was it like to just go from, you know, not being an author at all to just going into this industry head on?
Yeah, it was crazy. The first introduction, of course, was to the other author who represented herself as a professional writer. Who says what a professional writer is? You know, it's kind of like, was I a professional writer at that point? No. I mean, I had a day job. And since then, I've gone full time with our business. But you know, that level of, hey, I've previously been published and all that. So that was the first introduction. I was like, whoa, you know. And then the second level of introduction that was sort of like I was in the deep end of the pool was obviously with the agent. And she's a marvelous person. And what I didn't realize was agents kind of work in different ways, have different specialties. Her specialty was she was a senior vice president at one of the leading publishers in New York, and then created her own agency. And really what she does is serves as like a talent scout. So when the publishers want an author for a specific topic, they'll go talk to Marilyn and say, hey, you know, here's what we're looking for. And she'll find, you know, up and coming authors or people who are just, you know, fit that topic. And, you know, I didn't understand that's the way it worked. But since then it's been great.
Yeah, that's cool, because most authors think that, you know, I have to write query letters and I have to, you know, pound the pavement to find an agent. But, I mean, you didn't have to do any of that stuff. I mean, you basically skipped that entire, you know, process, which a lot of authors really hate to go through.
Yeah. No, it was actually the case that when they contacted me and said, hey, you know, Pinterest is the topic, you're the guy we want to have be the co-author, you know, your name would be first in the you know, book sort of structure. The idea that was interesting was they had it all figured out, and they knew who they wanted to sell the book to. So the book proposal was really sort of a formality. Yeah, I mean, basically what Marilyn said was, and she said, I've got a template. She's written the Idiot's Guide on writing, actually, so she had her own style kind of to follow in Word, and she said, here it is, you guys knock it out, I need it back in, you know, 3 or 4 days, and the guts of it really was the table of contents.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then they wanted to know, obviously, my audience and the degree to which I could actually, you know, help market the book. You know, those are crucial parts that they're looking for.
Mm-hmm. So how crucial was that? I mean, do you think if you had said, hey, I don't have any followers, I don't have any, you know, obviously it was just working on Pinterest, so you kind of needed some social proof, but yeah. I mean, do you think if you had almost no following, they would have still taken you on as the author?
You know, I think they were, given like 2 years of hindsight, I think they would have, because I've seen who the other publishers took, because now every publisher has a book out on Pinterest. I think, you know, even if I didn't have a following, just the fact that I was blogging about it so, you know, thoroughly, I think they probably would have gone with me. I think it was an added bonus that I actually had some list, and, you know, 1,000 good fans is sort of a classic idea, and I had some ability to do marketing. And it's proven that, you know, that's proven to be a good choice on their part. It is the case that it's the best Pinterest book out there in terms of sales volume and rank. I keep waiting for Chris Brogan or, you know, Guy Kawasaki to do a book on Pinterest, and then my book's going to totally, you know, tank. But so far, so good.
Yeah. Gotcha. So tell us about the marketing side, because I think a lot of authors, you know, they wonder, you know, how much marketing does the big publisher do for you? So how has that whole process been with marketing? Are you doing most of the work? Is your co-author doing most of the work? Or the publisher? How is that being split up?
Yeah, it was sort of the agreement at the beginning with the co-author that I would be the back-end marketer, and that her focus was just on really producing the written work. So that's been the agreement. You know, I think most people who look into traditional publishing will kind of tell you the same thing, and that's that, you know, you get assigned a publicist, and there is marketing that's done. There's a sales team, and there's a PR person that are assigned to your book. Whether your book is top of their agenda or not depends on a lot of factors. For Pinterest Power, I actually did have buy-in and support from McGraw-Hill to make it a top priority book for their sales team. And so that was cool. But, you know, the bulk of the heavy lifting, I would say, comes down to your pre-launch strategy with your own list and really getting early reviews and quality reviews from people who know, like, and trust you. So, you know, I think those are the crucial parts of it. The part that they did add value and a lot of help with was the introduction to sort of market leaders and sort of top tier, you know, kind of connections. American Marketing Association has done webinars with me now and podcasts, marketing profs. I had already been on Social Media Examiner. So, you know, those types of connections, they just have cachet and credibility. And they could call people or, you know, shoot an email to people and get me, you know, connected. So that helped. I actually, for the fun of it, I made, because I knew we were going to do this today, I made a list of the 7 things I like about self-publishing and the 8 things I like about traditional publishing, so we can get into that.
Yeah, sounds great.
If you want to. So, yeah. You want me to jump into it?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so here are the 7 things I like about traditional publishing. And, you know, I mean, obviously I'm trying to marry these two together. And all of my books are under the power kind of theme. So Pinterest Power, Instagram Power, Craft Business Power. So here's my set. So the 7 things I like about traditional publishing. First of all, the revenue structure is just obviously totally different. They work on the concept of an advance. And generally speaking, those are getting smaller, but it's still nice to get a chunk of money, you know, up front to do the book project. So that's cool. The second thing, obviously, is they have professional editors, typesetters, you know, formatting people. They'll produce a product that looks really, really fantastic. Cover design, they obviously have people who, that's their full-time job, is to make book covers, so you know you're going to get something that you really like, or at least something that's really professional, whether you like it or not. You kind of, that's an issue because you have to go back and forth with them if you don't, and we could talk about that. The fourth thing, which is probably the biggest thing for a lot of writers, is when you work with a traditional publisher and you sign the contract, you sign up to a timeline that you have to fulfill. So the accountability to finishing the work is baked into the deal, and you don't want to be one of the authors that, you know, doesn't submit your manuscript on time. And so that level of accountability is sort of just it's sort of a psychological support, just because you've signed a paper and you've gotten money, and you know the second half of the money of the advance is going to be given to you on delivery of the manuscript. You know, for me, that works well because I feel like I have a deadline that I have to hit. For some of my self-published projects, I mess around and then set it aside, and then I come back to it. The fifth thing they give, as I mentioned previously, is the PR team, the publicist. So, you know, that person will start introducing you to bloggers, podcasters, you know, companies. Sixth thing is a sales team. You know, it's just the case that for my traditional books, they end up on the shelf of Barnes & Noble. And, you know, the Craft Business Power book I did through CreateSpace, I don't know how to get it into bookstores. Maybe you do. Maybe you can help me with that. But the traditional books, those people have sales teams that go out and work with the big bookstores and get your book out there. The seventh thing is open doors. You know, I've been invited now to speak at big conferences, and you know, people who understand the publishing cycle see what books are coming out, and they'll use that as a trigger to invite guests and speakers. So, you know, real open doors have occurred because of it. And then the eighth thing is just credibility and legitimacy. You know, I still think there's a huge part of the population that says a traditionally published book has more believability than a self-published book. The ratings on Amazon don't prove that to be the case, but there's still a whole set of the population that would say, hey, if you're, you know, if your book's at Barnes & Noble, then you're the real deal in terms of publishing.
You must be really, really successful, right?
Yeah, you know, like that. So that's my list of eight things that I like about traditional publishing. You want me to do my self-publishing list?
Yeah, definitely. Let's go for it.
Self-publishing. Okay, the number one thing I like the most is speed. You know, if you've got a back catalog of writing that you can package up and edit and get ready to go, there's no barrier to implementation. You know, when you hit that upload button on KDP, I think they say 48 hours, but it never takes that long, you know, so it's fast. The second thing, you've got total control over the topic. You know, with, like what we were talking about earlier, with the traditional publishers, you have to talk them into the topic. And if you're really passionate about a topic, or if you think there's a market opportunity for a topic, and the publisher doesn't see it, then, you know, you just don't move forward with them. But with self-publishing, you can just run with it. And then you've got total control of the content, both inside and outside, the title, you know, the cover art, all of those aspects, the length. The McGraw-Hill book structure is 55,000 words. You know, my self-published books are smaller than that. The best one I've got out there, the Craft Business Power book, is 27,000 words, which is enough to make a print, you know, copy, a create space copy, but it's still quite a bit smaller than a traditionally published book. Mm-hmm. The fourth thing that I love, totally love, about self-publishing is pricing control. So not only can I, you know, set the price for the Kindle version and for CreateSpace, you know, the paperback version, I can also participate in things like the KDP, you know, promotions, make it free. And, you know, I think that's probably one of the biggest barriers to traditional publisher success right now is their pricing arrangement for ebooks. It's just not workable. I mean, you know, it's just a disaster for them.
What do you mean? Like, how do they price the books, and why is that not? Why is that an issue? Why is that not working for you as the author?
Well, as I understand it, they've got agreements with, I guess, their distribution channels and authors and whatever their mechanism by which they publish prohibits them from putting the Kindle price of their books down to what should be a rational level, which is the $2.99 to, you know, $5.99 level. And so all the traditional publishers are trying to move their Kindle books at the, you know, what, $11 level, that kind of pricing. It just doesn't work as well. So if you look at my traditionally published books, I'm selling more paperback books than I am Kindle books. If you look at my self-published books, it's the opposite. Mm-hmm. And that's a function of price. So that's a huge thing. Obviously, the best possible strategy is to have that I'm working on right now, is to have a book that's out there for free. And you just can't do that with traditional publishers.
Do you mean forever or free for a limited time for a promotion?
I'm going to try to do the free forever, yeah. You know. What do they call it, a perma-free hack, as I've learned from Steve Scott, and you know, you guys are experts at this stuff. So, you know, I want to do that strategy as well. So my fifth thing with self-publishing is the ability to coordinate pre-readers. You know, the pre-reader, pre-launch book strategy is really simple as an idea. Get people to pre-read it. They'll love it. They're your fans and followers. And then when it hits Amazon, ask them to leave a review. That's so logical. But if you publish with a traditional publisher, they won't let you do that because they don't want the book out there in a large way before the formal publish date. So with self-publishing, you can say, hey, it's the whole book's on my blog. Just go read it. Tell me what you think. And I love that strategy. It's helped a lot. The sixth thing I love about self-publishing, particularly CreateSpace, is the author pricing for buying copies. I can buy an author copy of Craft Business Power. Do you mind if I, where is it here? Let me show you. I can buy an author copy of this, Craft Business Power, for $2.50. So if I want to give it away for promotions, you know, contests, do it at a conference, an event, whatever, whatever, that's pretty cheap. My author copies for the traditionally published books, I can't buy them any cheaper than from the publisher than you can on Amazon. So $10 a copy. So that's pretty prohibitive. The seventh thing I like about self-publishing is the per book money is better. So you know, sell a million books self-published, and that's a lot of money. And it's just a better structure. You don't get the advance, but you get the per book revenue. It's just a better deal. So that's my list. So that's eight things I like about traditional published, and seventh thing I like about self-publishing. Yeah,
that's great. So let's talk about the last point, the money aspect, because you know, a lot of authors, there's this conception out there that you know traditional publishing, you're going to make so much more money. Yeah, that's just how it works. So I mean, is that true for you? How does the money break down?
Yeah. You want me to open the kimono a little bit on my book money?
Yeah, and you don't have to give specific numbers if you don't want to, but just give us a general idea at least. Yeah. You know, how does it work?
Yeah, no, I'm happy to do that. So the basic way it works at the high level, as I mentioned previously, is the traditional publishers work on the contract structure that has an advance, and it's basically broken in two. An advance before you start writing, and then a half of it when you deliver the manuscript. So you get your advance in two chunks, basically. At least that's been my experience. You get a chunk. So if your advance is, you know, $100,000 and you got $50,000 of it up front, that would be awesome. I don't know too many authors who get $100,000 advance. I guess the big shots would. I don't know. Our advance structure for Pinterest Power actually was kind of cool how it played out. I won't tell you the exact amounts, but basically the way it was like this. The publisher that first offered us an amount was a good offer. The agent said to the other acquisition editors at the other companies, hey, we've got an offer on this, so if you want to make a counter offer or a secondary, you know, offer, let us know. So she immediately, that triggered basically a bidding war, and she got two publishers to go back and forth. They went back and forth, I think, like four times. And then basically we settled. Sorry, my sun is shining behind me nice and bright here in Seattle. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay, wait. That's better. The sun usually doesn't come out in Seattle. So we settled on an amount that was four times more than the original amount. Now, I never would have been able to do that. I didn't know the rules of that game. I didn't know how negotiations worked. So it was an awesome reason to have an agent. So that's worked well. But of course, it was with a co-author, so the amount was going to be split. The subsequent books have done well. And, you know, I mean, like the subsequent books, I'll just tell you, like the second book, Instagram Power, I hope this isn't giving away any contractually obligated secrets or anything, but the advance was $11,000. So that was the amount. So on a self-published book like Craft Business Power, that's basically done almost as well. You know, that's this one. In terms of the sales rank and you know, that kind of thing, it's done as well. this last year as the Pinterest book. You know, it's given me, I think the first month I made like $1,100. Second month I think I made $900, and it's over the summertime it went down a bit, and now it's I think still in like the $600 to $700 a month range. So, you know, I mean, over the first year, that's not too dissimilar. Now, you know, I mean, if I was a big shot author and I got a $100,000 advance, then, you know, that would be different. But at least at my level right now, it's achievable to make the same amount of money, I would think, through self-publishing as it is through traditional publishing.
Really? So you think it's about equal in the long term that, you know, for any given book, whether you go traditional self-publishing, at least for you, it's going to make about the same amount of income for you?
Well, I guess, yeah, I mean, that'll be the thing to look out for over time. You know, the difference, of course, is that with the other part of the contract with a traditional published book is you don't get any royalty off per book sales until it earns out and makes back all of the money that they gave you in the advance. Well, you know, historically, people say 90% of books don't ever earn out. Mm-hmm. So authors that go with a traditional publishing deal, basically, I mean, the chances are your advance money is all the money you'll see from the book.
Wow. So that book then you got the $11,000 advance on, you don't think that's ever going to earn out royalties for you?
It depends on sales, right? Mm-hmm. So part of it is it depends on how hard I hustle it, how lucky I get, what, you know, how my other books in the catalog support it. So for me, I'm weaving together the traditional and the self-published, you know, style. So the catalog of books I'm trying to create right now is crucial. Just like how, you know, I know you, that's sort of the strategy you and others who are really leaders in self-publishing are kind of thinking about this stuff.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. So where do you see yourself in the future? I mean, are you going to continue to write more books? Do you see yourself primarily as an author or more as a businessman? Because I know you've got your entire business that you're running as well.
Yeah. I love to write. The business is going really, really well. We consider ourselves a design-driven publishing business, even though we're called Liberty Jane Clothing. We love that business. We think it's going to be $1 million business in the next, you know, like 24 months. So it's still tiny, but it's growing really well. And we've got huge opportunities there. But I think I'll probably, I just like to write. And so I'm always working on a new idea. And I don't see myself stopping. I think I've got a lot of room to run on this whole power trip, as I call it, you know, the Pinterest power, Instagram power. I'm working on a book right now. It's the one that'll be free called Internet Pricing Power.
Mm-hmm.
So I can run down that track for a long time. Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. So where do you see yourself over the next, you know, 5-10 years in terms of an author? Do you think they'll be more focused on self-publishing or traditional publishing, or are you still going to do a little bit of both?
My number one goal right now is to be in the top 100 authors on, you know, the Amazon rankings. And I know you're there all the time. That's awesome. I'm totally, you know, jealous. Congratulations. I think that's fantastic. I really, as I started to look into self-publishing, obviously saw your name a lot. I saw Steve Scott's name a lot. You guys are both installed, basically, in that top 100 authors in business and investing, alongside and even ahead of people, you know, that are industry superstars, you know, Robert Kiyosaki and, you know, on and on and on, you know, these people who are everybody knows. So I want to marry those two, and that's my near-term goal. So any tips or advice you can give me, I'm totally open to. Feel free to critique or whatever. And then what I'd really love to do is get to the point where I do a book launch that'll be a New York Times bestseller. And based on my research, what I think that means is I need to move, you know, 2,000 to 4,000 copies in the first week. And that is a bar that I think, you know, I think I could get to that bar someday. And it depends obviously on how much money I want to spend, if I wanted to advertise and that kind of thing. But those would be my two goals, the Amazon Top 100 and the New York Times. So.
Awesome. That's amazing. Well, Jason, thanks so much for sharing your story with us. I know it's been enlightening and inspiring, and hope all the authors listening and watching right now are really taking great notes and following your example, because I think you've done some amazing things, and I really appreciate you sharing your knowledge with us.
Thanks so much, man. I really appreciate the opportunity to connect. It's fun. So.
Yeah. So tell us before you go, where can people find out more information about you and your books?
Sure. Yeah. My main blog that's just sort of general topics related to marketing and business is makesellgrow.com. It's primarily written for those 1,300 seamstresses that I mentioned, the Liberty Jane Partners, but it's good stuff for everybody. And then the blog that I run for Pinterest is marketingonpinterest.com. And then obviously on Twitter and Instagram, Mr. Jason Miles is my handle. Jason Miles was already taken, so Mr. Jason Miles.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Jason, for being with us. I really appreciate it.
All right, man. All the best.
Awesome, man. Good job.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. It was a great interview.
Right. It goes by fast, as always, but...
Right. Yeah, man. It was really good.
Cool. Yeah. Well, thanks so much for the opportunity. I appreciate it. It's
absolutely.
I'm a huge fan of both you and Steve's, you know, and as I mentioned, that top 100 goal is mesmerizing to me. I don't know why. I'm just obsessed with the idea right now.
Well, it sounds like you should be pretty close. Are you checking your rank?
Yeah, I usually hover right around like the 200. I've been down to like the 120th, but usually I'm in the 200 to 300 kind of range. I'm thinking the perma-free hack with, you know.
That won't do it because it's a free.
It won't?
No, because it's a free, so it's a free ranking, not a paid ranking.
Oh.
Yeah, you need to be in the paid ranking. Let me see. So you know that...
any tips or advice, my brother?
Yeah, so okay, I'm looking at your books right now. So the rankings only count if you're listed in one of those categories. So like your Crash Business Power book...
Yeah.
...is in computers and technology. Oh, and it's in business and investing, so that will count.
Yeah.
So that one will count.
So I need to make sure they're all in business and investing.
Yeah, so if they're not in the business and investing category, those sales will not count.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I see a lot of yours are in computer and tech. So you can choose two main categories, right? You know that when you upload to KDP.
Yeah.
So I always try to choose one like that's in business and investing and one that might be in like computers or something else, right?
Yeah.
Doing that with each of your books, that'll help a lot. Yeah, so you might want to just choose those two. I would choose, you know, computers and tech and business investing. And if all your books are in one of those two main categories, then you're more likely to become top 100 in those categories.
Yeah, and that's pretty much what I've done. Anything else come to mind? 99-cent books, right? I just need more books. I need a bigger catalog.
I don't think 99-cent is actually a good idea anymore.
Really?
Not for long term. I do the $2.99 to $5.99.
Yeah.
And then do the Kindle Countdown deals at 99 cents.
Yeah.
If you want to get a big boost in sales. I'm not really doing free promotions anymore because they just Amazon changed their algorithm a couple months ago.
They don't work much that well, do they?
Well. Yeah. Yeah, man. And the other thing is just, you know, just write more books. I mean, if you got more information to share and you just keep writing, you know, one or two books a year, I mean, you're just bound to get there eventually.
Yeah. And that's kind of what I figured. My goal for this year is 6 books. So, you know, I figured if I can put 6 books out, and I already told my agent whether they're, you know, traditionally published or not, that's my goal. So I figure that if I can get one or two that really pops like Craft Business Power does, I think that'll help. Because, you know, of my self-published books, one is doing well, and two are sort of dogs, you know. Email Marketing Power and eBay Auction Power. Email does all right, but the eBay topic is just, either it's not hop at all, or, you know, my book just doesn't capture people's interest. But.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Yeah, sometimes you can try just changing the book cover if it's really not doing well.
Yeah.
You can try doing a Kindle Countdown deal promotion.
Yep, done that, and that seems to work really well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it just might be that eBay's kind of fallen out of favor. I mean,
yeah.
Most people that I know that have made their money on eBay, you know, they started years and years ago. There's not a lot of people, new people I know, that are doing it. So.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Awesome, man. Well, thank you so much for being with us again. I really do appreciate it. And if you need any help in the meantime, just let me know. I'm happy to help, man.
Thanks, dude. I really appreciate it. So let me know when it goes out. I'm on your list, so I'm sure I'll see it. But then I'll retweet it and all that kind of stuff. So.
Yeah, it'll be like Wednesday the 15th.
Okay. Yeah. Totally cool. Good times. Awesome. All the best.
Thanks, man. Have a great day.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye.